He basically said, it needs to sound like this. He laid in his back and he started playing the guitar and he was barely singing. It was coming out at almost a whisper. I was like, okay, stop, stop, stop. And I quick grabbed a couple of mics and plugged them in. I unplugged the phone. I turned the fans off and the tape machine and said, this is it. Just do what you think you need to do right now. And I literally held my breath for 3 minutes while he sang it. I mean, it was so quiet and yet it was so powerful. And that was the core of the track. It's very mournful, very quiet.
Underneath the bridge, top has sprung a leak, and the animals are trapped. All become my pets, and I'm living off of grass, and the drippings from the ceiling. It's okay to eat fish, 'cause they don't have any feelings. Something in the way.
Something in the Way is a complicated song because people instantly assumed that Cobain talked about himself living under this bridge, and it went down in legend that he lived under this bridge. Very few people end up homeless and are that separated from their families, but the emotional truth of what teenagers feel is so captured in that song, and that's something that we all go through in our normal existence on this earth.
Something in the way, yeah.
Coming up on the second verse again, gets very, very quiet. I'll bring in some of the instrumentation here. As we went back and overdubbed, it was very difficult for both Chris and Dave to do the drums and bass because with no click track, the timing was kind of all over the place. And I think I tortured him on it. Literally, at some points, we punched bar by bar just to make sure it was really languid. When Dave was doing the drums, Kurt was in the back of the control room saying, quieter, quieter, quieter. And I think it's in his nature to hit hard. But he played it very mellow, very understated. And they were recorded in Studio B at Sound City, which is a dead dry room compared to the big live room. Add the high harmonies in the chorus. Last, we brought in Kirk Canning to do a cello. And he had the same problem that Chris did trying to get the track in tune, to Kurt's funky five-string acoustic. So the track is a little out of tune, but that gives it kind of the eeriness. Or helps with it, gives it a lot of character. Very mournful cello sound.
You don't have to be an existentialist to get what Kurt Cobain is singing about on those songs. It's a universal truth in some ways, I think, that we all feel alienated from each other and from our own beings at time. And he just cut to the core and put it right there in his music.
Kurt was attractive to a lot of people, to a lot of young people who were maybe a bit confused about their place in the world, because I think they saw him and they heard his music and they heard somebody who was equally confused and unsure of their place in the world.
He was, you know, he was a reporter in a way. He wasn't just writing about himself, any more than John Lennon was or Bob Dylan. And he took all of this stuff and he made it sound like he was singing about you.
People picked up on Kurt, like, being the real thing. This is his calling. I mean, it's almost messianic in a way.
The song is called Smells Like Teen Spirit.
I totally remember the first time I heard Teen Spirit. They were playing at the OK Hotel, and it was the first time they played it live, and it was a huge show. I remember seeing it. It was like, okay, now it's all over. Like, now they're actually writing, you know, huge, amazing songs.
It's quite significant that of all the many catchy songs on Nevermind, that was one that hadn't been written maybe a year in advance. Songs like In Bloom and Lithium were already, you know, they were old Nirvana songs, but Smells Like Teen Spirit was a new one. It was one of the last ones they wrote before the album was finished recording.
In the chorus, we double tracked. They wanted to make it sound more powerful.
Life is stupid and contagious. Here we are.
And he was great at double tracking. He would just run down a take and do another take, and they always locked up really, really well.
I'm a skater, my libido, yeah.
Here comes the guitar solo. He basically copped the vocal melody. Instead of trying to come up with something punky or frantic or strangle a guitar like he usually did, he just copped the exact vocal melody. And it works really well. And then at the end of the solo, he lets it feed back into the third verse. It's got this great resonant feedback. We actually pulled it back in the final mix, but it would have been cool to leave it in there because it's got great overtones right through here. It starts to bend and morph. Really creepy sounding.
Kurt was on the button with, like, playing his guitar to deliver the sentiment of what he needs to get across. And that's the best guitar playing, you know.
You can hear his voice now in the last chorus.
I'm stupid.
It's starting to get pretty shot. He's been going so hard through the song, pushing so hard. Sounds like his vocal cords are starting to come right out of his throat. Especially when he gets to a denial. It's pretty powerful sounding.
I remember Butch putting up the rough mixes after Kurt laid the vocals down, and he'd be like, listen to this song. And he'd like crank it in the control room, and it'd just be like, it would just come out like just like a barrage, like, wow, did we do that? You know, it's just like, how did we do that?
I remember around the time we finished doing rough mixes and listening to everything back to back that I thought all the songs were really, really strong. And